Buenas tardes. I'm very excited to be here to talk about the Arctic. Peter has already talked about quite a few of the points that I'm going to make. If we can get up my slide, I'm going to get going, and we can also bring down the lights a little bit, because as a conservation photographer, I think this presentation should be more about the images than having a lot of light in the room. I had the privilege to be up in the Arctic for over 18 months, not in one stretch, but over several years. And for me, it has been a big challenge to photograph up there. And at the same time, it has been something that I've become to love. Are we gonna be able to get the picture up? Yeah, wonderful, thank you. I was the photographer for this book. It's called To the Arctic. It's a companion book also to our IMAX film, and the idea with the projects that I'm working on, including, for example, Freedom to Roam, is to do a body of work as a photographer, and with that body of work, that is often started with a book, we later on go out, make exhibits, many presentations to literally thousands of people live across Europe as well as across North America. And the idea with that is that we want to promote the conservation, we want to speak to people directly, but also use the media in order to get the word out. So we're going to go to the next slide. Yeah. Of course, photographing in the Arctic is a very harsh thing, and what I'm trying to do is take people with me on the ground and actually tell them a story about what it's like to photograph in the Arctic, to meet the animals, but also link the Arctic to their home in a way through the many migratory species that call the Arctic their home. And that is the birds, as we heard from Peter before. Why I started this project, I often get asked. It was the former Interior Secretary Gail Norton that called the Arctic a flat white nothingness. And it was a provocative statement that we now used. And I was asked basically by conservation organizations to go out and see what I would be able to find with the camera. So my challenge was to bring back images from the Arctic and show a place that was more than just a flat white nothingness. It's the home of millions of migratory caribou that are, you know, migrating across the Arctic and call the place their home, and of course of the big white polar bear, the species that so many people are fascinated with and that I'm going to be talking about more. Frank Murkowski called it a barren wasteland, and this barren wasteland yet is the home to the millions of birds that actually nest there every year. And it's the geese, it's the many shorebirds that travel along the shores, the coastline of the Western North America, but also across Europe. And they all need the Arctic as an intact place in order to rear their young. But it's not only the birds that need this place. Yet some politicians only want to see the Arctic as a place to exploit, you know, the oil industry in Prudhoe Bay, for example, but there's a many interest in resource exploitation all across the Arctic. Yet these migratory birds in the millions need the place to rear their young. But as I mentioned, it's not only the birds, it's the thousands and thousands of whales that migrate back to the Arctic every year. Like here, the gray whales that go, you know, through the Aleutians into the Bering and the Chukchi Sea. All of them need the Arctic in a most pristine way, and we want to keep it this way. In this presentation, I want to give you in between a moment so you can just lean back, enjoy the images, and let your imagination wander.
Thank you.
when we look in the top of the world, the Arctic is pretty much without light. I like this image that NASA created. And I love the areas that are called, you know, true wilderness. It pulls me there because I can find places where the world still looks like it always has before we humans expanded all over it. What I want to tell you too is a little bit the story of being out there on the ground photographing polar bears, because that's what people relate to. This is a possibility for us to get people excited about the Arctic. It's a harsh environment, and everybody, you know, associates that with the Arctic. For me, I had an opportunity to do a story for National Geographic on polar bears. It was one of the most exciting things to work on this book as well as on the story. To travel across the Arctic, a frozen ocean, and to look for polar bears. Here I'm scanning the horizon, looking for bears, and I can tell you, finding a white bear in a white landscape is not all that easy. We had to travel hundreds and hundreds of miles by snow machine. In other areas, like in Greenland, we traveled with Inuit hunters in order to look for the great white bear. What you see here is a perfect evening in the Arctic. It's about minus 30 degrees, but no wind and no blowing snow. But it changes from one moment to the other to something like this. Everything now is really about, you know, melting snow and ice in order to have something to drink. And by the way, the other person you saw there is my wife. She's originally from Mexico, and I convinced her to come with me into the Arctic. She's sleeping here right now, but only for about 2 to 3 hours. Then we have to change the places, and she's out in front of the tent polar bear guarding, because we always need to be on the watch for polar bears camping out there. Again, a beautiful evening, but then the weather changes again. Suddenly, complete whiteout conditions. In a moment like this, you want to just be in your warm sleeping bag and not get out of it, but you can't. You have to be on a constant watch for the polar bears, and that's of course also what we wanted to photograph. And can you imagine, in a situation like this is when we saw our first bear. Just like a ghost behind a curtain of snow, it appeared. And at the moment, in the first moment, we only thought it was one single bear, but then later on, we realized it was actually two bears that we discovered out there.
Here you can actually see the size difference. The male really seems to be twice the size of her. That's why we thought it was a cub at the first moment. And as they were coming closer, we realized it was actually a mating pair, or the male always circled the female.
Now, being out on the frozen ocean with these animals, an incredible experience. And I had done many expeditions, and in this one it was fantastic that I could actually be there with my wife. I've learned a lot about the bears in the course of the years. One of the things, of course, they are very curious. And in this situation, they're walking around us, and then one stops and turns in our direction. Then I have the feeling he turns to his buddy and says, "Hey, let's check out the photographer over there." Yeah, this is close enough. I'm screaming out. I used to do this with grizzly bears, but I can tell you with polar bears, that doesn't work. And when you look into the eyes like this, you get hot out there no matter what temperature. For me and my photography, it's all about creating a sense of place, and I want to be able to tell with one single story where the animals live. And so, and a lot of times when you got maybe one or the other telephoto shot, the important thing is that I want to, you know, create an image that I first think out, but that incorporates the landscape and possibly an additional story with it. And so here, at a whale carcass that washed up in Svalbard, I installed this box up to protect the camera from the polar bears, and I had a remote trigger. We did this at high tide when the bears were dispersed in the surrounding mountains, and then we quickly retreated. And I had a remote in my hand, and I was clicking away, as you see here, one of the big bears is coming back, and I'm so excited, click, 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 the whole time. He's smelling, there's something new, and you see he's close by, and I'm doing some more clicking, click, click, click. He's coming in front of the camera, another click, click, click. And then I'm suddenly thinking, oh my goodness, he's now gonna eat all the great pictures that I just took. And I can't wait to get back there to pick up the camera. And I'm so excited because these are moments, you know, after months and months out there that you are waiting for.
See if something turned out.
You see the smirky smile? I was so sure these were the best images ever.
I am way too far away. So one single picture. Oh, wait. Oh, no. Here's one. Holy good Lord. It's so crazy. I don't know what happened. I pressed reverse and it didn't show up. It was empty. Oh, they come over here. Look at that. It's beautiful, like a painting. These are cool too.
So now you see how the cover of my book To the Arctic was made, and the polar bear was this important species that, you know, I wanted to have on the cover because it transports the message of global warming. We've done many publications and of course also the presentations. There's the film To the Arctic, and the idea is to not only talk about the animals but about their habitat and global warming. A dramatic scene from a calving glacier. I've seen this firsthand in many different areas, and I've seen also polar bears out on the Arctic Ocean in different areas. And while I was out there, you know, and once you have gotten to know these animals directly, you think about everything a lot more differently. What you see here right now occurs every year. We've seen it earlier in the presentation, is the reduction of the sea ice in the course of the seasons. We're right now going into June, July, and the ice keeps on retreating. And normally it reaches its lowest extent at the end of August and the beginning of September, like you see here. What is so different now, and what has really become dramatic in the last couple of years, is how much the ice has been reduced. This is the lowest extent of ice that you see in 1979, and the yellow line is the average between that year and now in 2012, and the white is the reduction of the ice in 2012, and that yellow line is still the average. That shows how dramatic the development is. The ice is going away, the sea ice, the glaciers are melting, and the polar bears are suddenly stranded. So in the photography, I'm trying to create images like this one that symbolically explain what's happening, that they're losing the ice, it's melting away underneath their paws, and then they have nowhere to go. The longest recorded swim is over 500 miles of a polar bear, and often the cubs don't make it. Now, the WWF has created this map of what the sea ice might look like in 2014, and you see it's hanging on there in the edge of Greenland. But the global warming is such a huge thing that we often can't really grasp it, or it seems like we can't do anything about it. So I'm trying to fight with my imagery, supporting organizations too, like Earth Justice or the Alaska Wilderness League, and also in a new collaboration with the WWF, directly trying to prevent the development of oil platforms in the Arctic Ocean. And here, in front of Point Hope, you see this beautiful Arctic scene, and I'm juxtaposing an image on top of it of oil platforms, because that's the interest of the Shell, for example, to bring Arctic oil drilling in the Arctic Ocean, which is not really possible, because if you have an oil spill, for example, there's no way of cleaning it up in an Arctic environment, and the environment is so harsh with complete darkness during the winter months. The Kulig stranded, Kulig had multiple mishaps, so it shows even that one single platform, the drilling platform that they tried to use, is not really working properly. Now what you see here is a million signatures, over a million, with a joint effort of all the different conservation organizations, Greenpeace, Sierra Club, Audubon, Alaska Wilderness League, NRDC, and many more. We need to create a common voice, use the media in the best way possible. So circling back to the flat white nothingness, for me, the Arctic has become a colorful place, an amazing place, and it is still in many areas very remote and very pristine. And I hope we can keep it this way, even though we are impacting it. And I want to end the presentation with the following thoughts. Thank you very much. Thank you. If anybody wants to look at the book, you're very welcome to come up front here and take a look later.